value at stake are very high. For example, on Monday, October 1987, the Dow Jones Index was down by 22.61%. This crash, as described in the November cover of Time magazine, was of historic proportions. Considers that the Dow Jones lost almost a quarter of this value in a single day. And this is the large daily percentage loss in history. Now, the probability of these events was estimated by the expert to be around 10 to the power of minus 87. Namely, the probability was so small as to be considered practically impossible. To avoid this problem, at the end of the 80s, Roberto Magari wrote a book, Morale e Metamorale, un approccio probabilistico ai problemi morali, where he developed a decision theory that takes into account the potentially disastrous consequence of the small probability. Now, Roberto Magari was a very important logician and algebraist. He was the creator of the algebraic structure that allowed to deal diagonal phenomena in arithmetic theory using algebraic tools. In his honor, these algebras are today called Magari's algebras. Roberto Magari was also interested in philosophy and moral, and the book Morale e Metamorale, un approccio probabilistico a problemi morali, collects some of his moral philosophy idea. The theory developed by Magari in the second chapter of this book is very interesting because his theory tried to solve the problem that we have just highlighted in the classical decision theory, try the example of Black Monday. Magari theory extends the classical decision theory by allowing the range of probability function and the utility function to be an ordered field, and possibly a non-Archimedean field. So in Magari decision theory, degree of belief are represented by probability function with ordered field as range, preference by utility function with non-Archimedean field as range, and the decision rule is expected utility maximization. Intuitively, a non-Archimedean field is an algebraic structure in which we can express the infinity of some quantities. In this field, we have, in fact, infinitely small number and infinitely large number. Let's see the formal definition of the non-Archimedean field. Okay, a field is an algebraic structure that satisfies these six axioms. For example, a familiar field is that of the real number, where the two binary operations are the sum and the product between real number, and the two distinct elements are 0 and 1. In fact, sum and product between real numbers are both associative and are both commutative. The product distributes over the sum. 1 is the identity element for product, 0 is the identity element for sum, and every real number different from 0 as the product inverse, and every real number as the sum inverse. An ordered field is a field in which a binary relation is defined that satisfies this axiom. A familiar ordered file is that of real number, where the binary relation is the usual order relation between real number. In fact, the usual order relation between real number is reflexive, is symmetric, is transitive, and is total. Moreover, the sum and product between real number are compatible with this relation. we can now define a non-Archimedean field. A non-Archimedean field K, another field K is said Archimedean if for each x, y in K, such that 0 is less than x, then there is a natural number n such that y is less than nx. So in an Archimedean ordered field, given an element x, we can always find an element that is greater than x. An ordered field file K is non-Archimedean if it doesn't satisfy the Archimedean property. Okay, we can see now how it's possible to express quantity infinitely small and infinitely large in an Archimedean field. An element epsilon of an ordered field is called infinitesimal if for every real number r, epsilon is less than r. So infinitesimals are numbers smaller than all positive real numbers. A number omega is said infinite if for every real number r, r is less than the absolute value of omega. So infinities are a number whose absolute value is larger than all real number. Let's give a visual representation of infinite number and infinitesimal number. In order to do so, we need an infinitesimal microscope and an infinite telescope. We suppose that this is the real line, our microscope, this, show us an infinitely small portion of space near zero, and this is an infinitesimal positive and is a negative infinitesimal. Our telescope show us a portion of space that goes beyond the real line on both sides, positive and negative, and this is a positive infinite and this is a negative infinite. So, from the definition of non-Archimedean field and the definition of infinitesimal, follow this theorem. An ordered field K is non-Archimedean if and only if contain infinitesimals different from zero. Remark, a number epsilon different from zero is infinitesimal if and only if its inverse is infinite. So,
what's a real number in a general non-Archimedean field? You say that for every real, what's a real in a general non-Archimedean field?
Real is this number. This is the real line. So every point is a real number. This portion is the infinitesimal number, and this is the infinite number, because
in a general non-Archimedean field, how can I tell whether a number of that field is real or not?
One unity.
Sorry, I think the quickest answer is there is only one unity which satisfies the property that you multiply a times one and it's a, and it's the real unity basically. I think that's what he was asking.
Aspetta, non ho capito. Però dimmela in italiano, magari la capisco.
Ci possono essere tanti livelli di infinitesimali infiniti. Lui chiedeva quale di questi chiami reali.
Quali di questi?
Chiami reali.
No, reali non li chiamo nessuno. Reali sono questi numeri qua. Gli infinitesimi sono altri numeri, non sono reali. Questo qui sarebbero iperreali, vengono chiamati. Sia gli infinitesimi che gli infiniti vengono chiamati numeri iperreali. Sono al di fuori della linea dei reali, in qualche modo.
Ok, so it's a particular case. Ok, you define it such. Yeah.
Okay, no, just a clarification. The point maybe that Jacopo just went too fast on that. If you have any non-Archimedean field, basically there is an Archimedean sub, a subfield, which is Archimedean and then the real line. Okay, so that's the thing, that there is just one Archimedean field, which is the real line, and in every field, in every non-Archimedean field, you take the Archimedean subfield, and those are the reals. Okay?
Okay. If K is a non-Archimedean order field, then K contains infinite. Therefore, a non-Archimedean field is an algebraic structure which we can express infinitely small number and infinitely large number. We can now see Roberto Magari decision theory under risk. With S, we define the set of state. With A, we define the set of acts. With K, we define an order field. And with L, we define an order field such that K is a subfield of L. With the notation PIA, we denote the probability that the situation SA occurs at instant t plus 1 if we perform action A at instant t. We associate to H8A a sequence P1A up to PN. A such that the sum of this probability is 1, given a set S with cardinality n, we denote by Pn the set of all action over S. A very interesting thing to point out in Magari decision theory is that it considers its works as a part of moral theory, and indeed he speaks of morals. And in Magari decision theory, a morals F is a way to choosing among a set X of possible action, the subset Fx or X consisting of those actions which are considered the best one among all action in X. A moral F is said Pascal if there exists a utility function U from S to an ordered file L, possibly non-Archimedean, such that if X belongs to the domain of F and A and B belong to Fx, then the expected utility of A is equal to the expected utility of B. And if X belongs to the domain of F, and A and B belong to the set X, and B belong to Fx, but A doesn't belong to Fx, then the expected utility of A is strictly less than the expected utility of B. Magari's problem is now to find general condition that may establish when a moral is Pascal. Therefore, for this reason, he defined a preference relation over the acts. Given a moral F, we can define a preference relation over acts by setting act A is not preferred to act B if and only if B belongs to Fx, but A doesn't belong to Fx. A preference relation is Pascal if and only if it respects the expected utility. So A is not preferred to act B if and only if the expected utility of A is strictly less than the expected utility of B. We can define the indifference relation between acts by setting A is indifferent to B if and only if A is not preferred to B and B is not preferred to A. Given this definition, it can be proved that every preference relation is transitive and anti-reflexive. Every indifferent relation is an equivalence relation. two acts are mutually indifferent if and only if they have the same preference relationship compared to any other acts, and given two acts, they are indifferent or one is preferred to the other. A binary relation satisfying condition 1, 3, and 4 will be called a near order relation. Given the condition of linearity, Roberto Magari proved the following representation theorem. A moral F is Pascal if and only if its associated relation is a linear near order. Let's see an example of how decision theory developed by Roberto Magari considers the potentially disaster consequence of small probability. Suppose we have 3x. S1 is an indifferent situation for the person who has to make the choice. S2 is safe for life. S3 have a bed to take. We have 2x. XA is described by the triple 100, and act B is described by the triple 0R1-R, where R is arbitrary close to zero. U is a utility function from S to L, where L is an order field, for example, R, the field of the real number. Now, if we can suppose that the value of P2B U2S2 is very close to zero, because P2B is arbitrarily close to zero. And we can suppose that US1 is greater than US3. And so the expected utility of B is less than the expected utility of A. And thanks to the representation theorem, we have that act B is not preferred to act A. Now, for Roberto Magari, independently of the value of P2B, a person in this situation must choose action B, because at stake there are inestimable value, that is the life of a person. And here you can use the non-Archimedean field. In fact, if K is a non-Archimedean order field and US2 is a positive infinite, then the expected utility of A is less than the expected utility of B, because the value of P2P US2 is infinite, and the sum of infinite and a real number is an infinite, and so this is an infinite. On the other hand, the expected utility of A is a real number. And so we have that the expected utility of A is less than the expected utility of B by definition of infinite. So, thanks to the representation theorem, we have that the act A is not preferred to act B. In conclusion, the starting point of Roberto Magari is the observation that very often when we have to deal with a small probability, the value at stake are inestimable. Since the classical decision theory disregard the potentially disastrous consequence of small probability, Magari developed a decision theory whose main characteristics are the following. Extend the classical decision theory, maintain the classical assumption. Introduce possibly non-Archimedean order field as the range of probability function and utility function, and deal with case in which state has a small probability and inestimable value. So, Magari decision theory is an initial attempt to deal with those events that in Taleb's words, we can call the black swan, that is, events characterized by low probability and massive impact. Okay, this is some of the reference. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jacopo. There are questions? Yes.
So I was, you know, a bit confused because you start your talk talking about an event which apparently had, you know, a probability which was so small that maybe I could think of it as an infinitesimal, but then you only stressed that utilities take values in an Archimedean field, not probabilities. Now, in the previous slides, I saw that also probabilities can be non-Archimedean.
Allora, magari fa la teoria in modo molto generale, cioè lui introduce campi non archimedei sia come codominio di funzioni di probabilità che come codominio di funzioni di utilità. E questo è abbastanza... Ora questo non funziona più. Anzi, mettiamolo qui. È abbastanza chiaro dal momento che lui quello che cerca di fare è appunto salvare quegli eventi che hanno piccola probabilità ma un impatto veramente grosso. E quindi quando noi siamo a massimizzare, pensiamo di avere solo un evento, qui abbiamo due cose da fare. O lavoriamo sulla probabilità o sull'utilità, perché lui vuole salvare lo schema classico. Ora, evidentemente lavorare con la probabilità è qualcosa di più complicato, anche perché è una funzione più complicata di quella dell'utilità. In qualche modo l'utilità ci basta un ordine. E quindi lui quello che fa è definire, come ho fatto vedere nell'esempio, cioè di utilizzare il campo non archimedeo solo per la funzione di utilità. E per quanto riguarda la probabilità, lui nelle conclusioni dice... È un argomento interessante da sviluppare, perché poi lui purtroppo non ha sviluppato molto questa teoria. Ci ha lavorato in fondo agli anni Ottanta, poi è morto e quindi non ha continuato molto. Però vedeva molto interessante sia la possibilità di continuare questo tipo di teoria che la possibilità di lavorare con probabilità che hanno come codominio campi non archimedei. E questo, cioè io non capisco bene come si possa lavorare con campi non archimedei. Cioè, che cosa vuol dire che la probabilità di un evento abbia un infinito? Però è molto interessante sull'infinitesimi. Sull'infinitesimi è un
So, if I may say, so from what you are saying, I infer that there is a literature that you should explore because it relates to this of papers that I don't know whether they are contemporaneous or came.
Non ho capito.
Dovresti esplorare
Ok, ma perché lo sto guardando da poco tempo, quindi forse ho capito. Mi parli di Hammond, dei lavori suoi?
Anche Hammond.
Sì, quelli li ho visti. Questi non li conosco, quindi grazie.
Hanno una cosa un po' diversa, loro parlano di utilità attesa lessicografica, però si può anche reinterpretare quello che fanno in termini, cioè, ovviamente tolgono la sioma archimedica dalla probabilità, ok?
Ok.
E menzionano esplicitamente che si può riformulare quello che fanno in termini di probabilità infinitesima.
Ok, grazie, questo è interessante, molto...
La domanda si sovrappone in realtà un po' con quella che è appena stata fatta, però è per dire save a life mi sembra un ottimo esempio, soprattutto se si usa la parola moral.
Infatti sì,
cioè, la crisi, il crash questo. Finanziario è un crash grosso, ma non ha nulla di non archimedeo.
Allora quello lì era un esempio per far vedere certi...
Sì, ma dico per dire, secondo me è interessante più per l'aspetto morale della conseguenza che per l'aspetto della piccola probabilità.
Sì, ma infatti lui sviluppa la morale in questo, cioè sviluppa la teoria in questo modo, infatti la chiama morale.
È molto...
Non lo so perché lui non fa riferimento a questo, dice che cioè quello che lui vuole è appunto salvare la teoria classica della decisione in qualche modo e quindi quello che lui interessa è la massimizzazione dell'utilità e dice questa qui era già conosciuta a tempi di Pascal, questa è l'unica cosa che io ho, l'unico riferimento che dice.
Grazie.